Good morning. Come on, you can do better than this. Good morning. Thank you. I was listening to the previous speech and also the welcome address of Mr. Agnihotri. Just, I was reflecting on it and I thought, I will start with I would say very emotional or something very personal. 1962, November 18th, China attacked India. And I remember I was in kindergarten class. The teacher came and said, the Chinese army has crossed Bhalukpong, which is part of Arunachal, and they are now coming towards Tejpur, where I was born and raised. And the Chinese army at present is close to 22 kilometers from the school, and the government has asked us to vacate the town. So we are trying to reach your parents, and they will be here shortly to take you home. And I remember my father came. We all were walking back home. On the way, saw State Bank of India. The government was burning the currencies because just we don't want to lose. And I remember that evening, we left Tejpur town in a truck. In those days, there was no bridge over river Brahmaputra. So overnight, we stayed on this side. In the morning, with the ferry, we crossed, and it took about 8 days to come from Tejpur to Rohtak, where my grandparents live, and my grandfather is a school teacher there. This is November 18, 1962. 55 years later, almost the same day, one of those refugees was announced as the president of a business school of China, and that's Dipak Jain. So you just imagine, this is 55 years later. I never knew that of all the countries in the world that they will pick an Indian to be the president, but this is what I consider is the power of education. And more than that, it is Indian parents' commitment to education. If there is one differentiation, I will tell in my 40 years of teaching, what makes Indians different is, for Indian parents, the first priority is ki bachcho ko kaise achhi taalim di jaye. Taking vacation and going and seeing something is not a part of the regular vocabulary. At least it was not part of it over the years we grew up. It's changing, and I think changing for the right reason. But I hope that that commitment or that flame continues to be lighted for years to come, because this is what is going to make us who we are. Mr. Agnihotri used the word who's who a lot. And I tell you that this who's who only works when you have the chair. You are the dean, people think you're who's who. The day you leave, from who's who, you become who's he. Right? That's how the life is. That yes. So this whole, jo kehte na ki kissa kursi ka, that is absolutely true. But then you have to find another chair. So right, so that you continue to do that. And I feel blessed as an Indian. I grew up in Tejpur, small town. Not much resources, and never thought that I will ever get out of Assam. You know, Assamese people are very nice, and we all are very simple, but for first 25 years, I never had the chance to go anywhere. When I finished my bachelor's degree from Dharam College in Tejpur with a honors in mathematics, my father, I remember, first took me to the bus station to put me in a bus to go to Guwahati to do my master's. That was my first journey. And never knew a boy who first sat in a bus after so many years would one day become the director of United Airlines, the largest airline in the world. So you can just see, when the topic came of faculty, and Amit approached me, I thought that the biggest impact we Indians have made on management education is because of us as Indian faculty. Today, the journey is moving from faculty to administrators. In 2001, I was the first Indian to become the dean of a top business school. It had never happened. And it was a great pressure on me because you are going to set the example. And I remember many of my students came to me and said, because before me, the dean was Don Jacobs, who was the dean of Kellogg School for 26 years. And he was a very unique individual. If I share the stories with you, very tough person to deal with. And I worked with him very closely, and he brought Kellogg to greater heights, to great heights. So when I was announced as the dean, I remember a lot of people came to me and said, Dipak, we can easily see the downside. We don't know what the upside potential is there for the school. I thought that was the best compliment you can get because the expectations were so low that even if I do marginally better, things can get, and that is a part of marketing that set the expectations low. But 2001, September 11th, you remember the day? That was the day, my first day as the dean of Kellogg School. I started my journey that day. I was welcoming 600 MBA students. About 12 minutes into my presentation, our director of corporate communications walked to the podium and said, Dean Jain, there has been a terrorist attack on the US soil. You need to shut up before the cell phones start ringing. Who would have ever anticipated an event like this? Now, people may say, okay, this is not a good omen to start with, but you know, you cannot undo it. Uncertainty is inevitable. Worrying is optional. One thing I never worry about is that whatever has happened, you cannot undo it. You need to make the best use of it. And what happens in business schools is events like this would affect our MBAs the most. Because for corporations, it became a great excuse to withdraw offers they had made to students. And I tell you, after this, when I came to my office, there were students who were supposed to join. Normally in US, you start your job sometimes after 15 September, the fall, or 1st of October. And that was the time when students started getting letters from companies that we are withdrawing the offer. And I had many students in my office. Some, in some cases, the wives are pregnant and they, now they don't have medical insurance. And really it was a day when you see the 7th, September 11th. And then for students, when they come to business schools, they come with high aspirations. And now, what you do about it? So I called some of my colleagues from other business schools. They said, Dipak, this, you are not the only one who is going to be affected. This is a global problem, so why worry about it? Now remember one thing. We all live under the same sky, but we seem to have different horizons. So I thought that, yes, it has affected all of us, but it does not mean that we all keep quiet. So I decided to do one thing, and that was I contacted my students whom I had taught over the years. And I remember writing a letter to them asking if they had any work in their environment. I had about 66 students who were in real trouble. I wrote that letter. Somehow the letter got out in the press. And I was approached by CNN to come for a talk. I could not make the day, and I will tell you why. So I decided I could not go it. And that letter, there is a person you may have heard called Lou Dobbs, a CNN anchor. He had a story saying, Kellogg Dean begging for jobs. That was the exact headline, Kellogg Dean begging for jobs. I thought that was the best publicity you can get without paying for any advertising. Right? At least everyone knew that there was an Indian guy as a dean of Kellogg. I tell you, that year, 2001, 2002, since October 3rd, which was the first day the plane started flying, till April 12th of 2002, there was hardly a day I was not on the flight trying to reach out to all the recruiters. And I tried my best to keep United in business, but it went bankrupt, but that was a different reason. But I tell you, in 2002, when Business Week had the survey, Kellogg School not only got the number one top-ranked business school, but there was an article on Dean Jain saying that how he made it possible for the students to still get the best job. And the title was, I tell you, the title of that article was, "I have a bad habit. My hands move faster than my tongue. So I touch people when I talk." So the title of the article was, "The Hugging Dean Makes a Difference." Right? And I thought that that was a good thing to say. The reason I bring these stories is, we are who we are. We cannot change our color. We cannot change the way we speak. We are born with that. But we need to make the best use of our strengths. Don't consider this as a limitation or anything. You may have your own accent, but what people like is your intentions. Your intentions may be invisible, but it's not invisible to people who see what's inside you. My father was blind. He always used to say, "Beta, jhole mein rakhi hui cheez se jhole ki kimat nahi jyada honi chahiye. Log jhola chura lenge." The bag should not be worth more than its content. So try to be who you are, but make sure that the content inside is good enough that nobody steals the bag, and the bag would always be there, and then you can always speak on behalf of that bag. So when Mr. Nair was mentioning about the three people in his thing, I come from a family with a blind father and a mother who never went to school. But my father only said, "Beta, hum tumhe kuch nahi de sakte hain. Achha se padh lo, aur wo padhai hi tumhari keemat hai." And I tell you, I stand here today, first in 2001, served as the Dean of Kellogg in US. I was the first Indian to be the Dean of a European business school, which is more difficult to be in France and be accepted as an Indian to head the institution. And now today, as the president of a business school in China. I give this tribute to my parents, my teachers, and to Ma Saraswati. And I would just share a few words with you, but something I want to bring to your attention during my talk. So let me just give you a few perspectives on this thing. Life is never smooth. I did a lot, but in 2012, I went through a very tough time. It was February 1st, 2012. I was diagnosed with brain tumor with cancer. That's the worst that can happen to an intellectual, right? The only power you have is the brain, and that gets infected. Anyway, I was operated, and the person who operated me was a student of mine in 1996. He was a doctor in the executive MBA. When he heard that I was sick, he had retired, moved to San Francisco. But when I was on the operating table, he decided to be there. Flew all the way from San Francisco to Chicago. A young doctor operated me, but he was there to make sure that things went fine. The tumor was somewhere between my speech and memory area, deep inside. The doctor can only save one of the two. They tried to save my speech, so I lost a lot of memory. I used to have a very perfect memory, but you know, some trade-off is necessary. But I tell you, you realize the power of a faculty at that day. Students remember the teachers, not only who taught them, but teachers who taught them, touched them, and made a difference. So the role of a faculty member is not just to teach, but the role of a faculty member is to create an interest in the topic. Then only, because you cannot teach the whole physics subject in a semester, but you teach it enough for that person to make sure that I want to become a physics professor, or I want to use physics as a way to make my difference. So I feel blessed over the years that I had some great teachers, great mentors, and teaching is something I never considered as a profession. Teaching is something I worship. Going to a classroom to me is like going to a temple. That's my philosophy. Because when I go there, my grandfather was a school teacher, and he always told me, he said, Dipak, your father cannot see light. You need to give light to the world. And that's why when the first ceremony started, I told Tom, this is what my name means. And any time you get to light a lamp is what I go back to my roots. And I remember the day when my grandfather told me, he taught for 49 years, 24 years as a teacher and 25 years as the headmaster of a Jain high school in Rohtak. So teaching is something I worship. And I tell you, there is no better profession in the world than being a teacher. So the reason I said this is, while I was recovering from my brain surgery, I started thinking about how businesses have evolved and how management education should evolve over time. You know, when you are recovering from sickness, the best thing you can do is think. So I started thinking, and I tell you what my views are. So if you look at, I will show you a structure. Up to the 19th century, I would say that the business model used to be a model of what I call land acquisition or colonialism. We Indians were ruled by the British, and that was the business model that prevailed until recently, I would say. The players were countries, and the metric they used was called power. And I remember in 62, since in Assam at that time, there were a lot of missionary teachers. And there was a phrase that the sun never sets on the British Empire. There was some country in the world where British were ruling 24/7, 365 days a year. And that was what it was. Then the model changed. America came to this country, and the needle shifted from, I would say, colonialism to this needle of capitalism. Free market competition. And now the countries were no longer the players. The players became corporations. You may have heard a company called John Deere. They make tractors. I am a director. We just celebrated 180 years. The oldest company happens to be DuPont of all American companies, has a history of 200. So if you look at the last 200 years, the most of them were driven by corporations. And Vinit mentioned this whole concept of management education evolving with industrialization. Because when you have industries coming, you also need management and so on. And now the metric shifted from power to profits, or you can call it share price. And the success was, how good is the share price? Vinit mentioned the company HCL grew from 1 billion to 20 billion and other. These are the metrics you need to explain. Many of you may have heard that if you see over this year, a person who really made capitalism was a person called Milton Friedman. Right? He is there, professor at Chicago. When I became the dean, it was a very big dream of mine to interact with him, because I didn't go to a business school. I did a bachelor's in mathematics honors, a master's in mathematical statistics, and a PhD in operations research. So I had never went to a business school, never studied business. So I thought I should get to meet him. So I was giving a lecture at an alumni event, and it was a fundraising dinner. And one person came to me and said, Professor Jain, I have no money to give you, but I can get you an appointment with Mr. Friedman. I said, that's more than giving. So I remember in 2003, July, I went to see him. And I asked him his notion about corporations. And in those days, if you remember, after September 11th, the CSR became very popular. But he told me, he said, Dipak, the only social responsibility of business is to make profits. What you do with profits is secondary, because your first responsibility is to the shareholders. They are investing in you. Now, his point was, profits is necessary. So do focus on it. But what you do with it and how you distribute is a different part. Don't lose the focus. That was his message he gave me. And he made a very interesting comment. When I asked him about government in other countries, he says, Dipak, if you let the government run the Sahara Desert, in 10 years, there would be shortage of sand. Right? That was his view about government. He said that in 10 years, there would be shortage of sand. His point was, management education is very critical. Managing resources is not only an art, a science, a skill, and that is something I feel very good. You have now become the dean of the school. We finished the lunch. He hugged me and he said one sentence. He says, Kellogg may be number one in Business Week ranking, but Kellogg is no Chicago. University of Chicago is still intellectually superior than Kellogg. I thought a man at 92 years old, that was his passion. Let him live with that passion. The point is, when you meet people like this, it gives you lots of inspiration. And he really believed in this model. If you look today I describe that we are in a state of what I called human capital. People talk about artificial intelligence, everything, but there is no substitute to working with a good human being. And I really believe our core purpose is attracting and shaping human talent. That's what business schools is about. This is what the business we are in, how you make sure that you get the best talent. And today, the players are no longer countries or corporations, it's citizens. In my lifetime, I have seen when Bill Gates started Microsoft. Mark Zuckerberg created Facebook. So if you look at the people today, all the big companies you hear were started with a citizen, an individual. So the power is in the hands of these individuals, and they have bright ideas. They have innovative mindset. What is the role of a business school? I get this question a lot, that what do you teach in business schools? People say when we go and teach mathematics, there is a structure. That when we go physics, there are laws of Newton and Einstein and others. What do you teach in business schools? I tell you what I say. I tell the people who ask me this question, I tell them in business schools, what we teach our students is how you put structure on unstructured problems. Business school is structured thinking because business problems are unstructured. Your sales are going down, you lost market share. Vinit said that our margins from 25% went down to 17-18%. How you think of solving, or what you call problems to solutions, a structured approach to thinking is what business schools are about. And what we really focus, I'd say, in business schools is four things. One is skills, tools, concepts, and execution. We teach you a set of skills. You learn tools, how to segment market. We teach you different concepts, a 2x2 matrix that BCG would create. And these are structures that we create. In those structures, you come across what are your strengths, what are your weaknesses, what are the opportunities you have, what are the threats, what are the resources, what is the time frame, and then you come up with option 1, 2, 3. All these case studies are basically that. And then the success lies in who does the best execution. Many people get advice, few benefit from it. We teach the same subject to 50, 60 students. One or two will pick up that advice and make something out of it. So today, the young generation is not just driven by profits. They have a purpose. You look at Bill Gates. I remember in 98, we invited him to give a lecture at Kellogg. At that time, the only thing that mattered to him was profits. Market share of Microsoft was doubling every year. But you look at it today, he is focused on a purpose. And I tell you that purpose means making a difference. So when I was the dean of Kellogg School, and every business school has to go through a branding exercise, the brand of Kellogg School, I used to tell my students, first you have to be successful in life. Don't be an idealist and say, I want to go to Africa and solve the poverty problem of the world. first created a platform of success. Chadhte suraj ko har aadmi salam karta hai. People respect you because you have achieved something. But don't stop the journey there. While you are successful, start the journey of significance. Don't wait till you retire, because I told you, from who's who you become who's he. Nobody would give you any resources. So the brand of Kellogg School was, by joining the Kellogg School, you start your journey from success to significance. So that was the branding of Kellogg, from success to significance. That is very important. I come to INSEAD, and they had hired a consultant, and the consultant said, INSEAD, the business school for the world. I thought of making a correction. I said, business school for a better world. Put a small tick there and write the word better. It would be so pronounced that people would say creating. Some or other, they didn't like it. So they said, no, business school for the world. That was my personal. I come to China, and our thing was China depth, global breadth. This is our 25th year of the business school, and we have changed it to China essence, global significance. And I tell you, the Chinese were very thrilled to get this word significance in their vocabulary. And no matter what we say, in a short 20, 25 years, you have seen a country from almost nothing to becoming the second superpower. 13.4 or 13.5 trillion next to US is not a matter of joke. In 2001-2, when we created the business school in Hong Kong with Kellogg, people of Hong Kong who were rich used to go to Shenzhen to buy fresh fish. Today, the economy of Shenzhen, the GDP is bigger than Hong Kong, just one town. So this is the power of execution, and they have done this. But I tell you, if you look at businesses, I really believe the best days are ahead of us. Because this young generation, the word that is used, the millennials, my children are not driven just by profits. They have seen the best of the world. They have a purpose in mind. So I am a very big optimistic that the best days are ahead of us. We are going through a turbulent period, but these new millennials are going to make this world purpose-driven, and we would see lots of initiatives of significance moving forward. Given this, I just want to say you have to tell me when to shut up, but I will just share with you a few thoughts and then I will leave. How management education has evolved. So this is business, and today the theme is here. I will go through the same, as you must have noted, that being a mathematician, I just think of having some structure there so that you have a logical thinking behind it. Business schools started, and up to the 60s, the basic model was driven by case studies that we all know. Harvard made a brand out of it, Harvard cases. And the decision making, I said, was driven by judgment and intuition. You discuss cases, you look at all possible options, you decide. And the focus was what I call business relevance. In 1959, there was a commission set up called the Ford Commission. And the purpose of that commission was to look at, is this the way to teach management education? Or there should be some pedagogical innovations that can make management education better, because post-World War, 1945, businesses were growing exponentially. And the idea was, are we doing the right thing in training people who are going to be the future leaders? So 1959 to 1961 was what I would call an inflection point, that many deans and heads of business schools were sent to the Harvard Business School for a year. And that year, they were taught a lot of analytical frameworks. That's the period when this operations research, the concept of optimization, and the consulting firms, all these things started. And I tell you, this period I consider to be the golden period of management education, from 1960s to 2000, analytical frameworks, lot of analytical models, consulting business started, and the focus shifted from just business relevance to academic excellence. people like us who are training in basic disciplines move to business schools from mathematics, statistics, economics, anthropology, physics, because you need the basic skills, and then we shifted to teaching management education. Same thing you see in India. I have seen people moving this part. This was the period when research became very prominent. If you look today, 2000 and beyond, a very important part of management education is what I call experiential global learning. Students go to different countries because we want them, because the world is becoming a community. And as I said, that if citizens are going to be the players, people ask me, what's next, Dipak? From citizen, the next word would be communities. From countries to corporations to citizens to community, a person from India, a person from China, and a person from US through the internet can create companies of the future. So we need to have this experiential global learning. And very important is what happened in 2001 with the fall of Enron, curriculum driven by business ethics, sustainability, CSR is important. And then the third part in business school is what I call social significance. So when I tell a business school dean, there are three important things for you: academic excellence, business relevance, and social significance. And they need to be perfectly integrated in order to be a good professor, a good dean, and a good institution. You cannot just pick only one. If you look at an integrated approach, that would be fine. So I would conclude by saying that. So how does reputation comes from business schools? And this is my last thing I would say is, the first thing that matters is input, attracting quality students. Throughput is quality curriculum and faculty. And then the output is quality placement. Now, if you look at an operations chain, input, throughput, output, if you see, we try to attract the best students, we create the best curriculum and faculty, and output is the placement. This conference theme is on the faculty, and I just want to conclude with a few thoughts here. And this is my personal experience. I think we Indians made a big difference in America. Today, if you look at business schools, lots of us as professors. And in 2001 beginning, we started the journey of getting into administration. And you saw that picture of Nitin. Madhav Rajan is the head of Chicago. My other job was to be, I got the offer to be the dean of MIT, Sloan School. I decided not to go because I thought by going there, I would compete with Kellogg. And that's why I thought the best way is what they call the blue ocean, get out of the competition and moved out to China and INSEAD. Honestly, I decided not to do this. Of the top seven schools, Harvard, Stanford, MIT, Kellogg, Chicago, and Columbia, of the seven schools, if four are Indians, deans, that's a tribute to this country, to Mother India. It's not a matter of joke. Getting the deanship of Kellogg and Harvard and then MIT and now Chicago, this says something about us. But I tell you one thing, which I'm very disappointed, and that is, today, we are not sending our best students for PhD programs to create the faculty of the future. For some reason, for Indian parents, Lakshmi has become more important than Saraswati. I just feel getting a job with McKinsey or Goldman Sachs at IIT, my only request, and this is my sincere request to all of you, is if you have good students, do push them to go for PhD programs in US, become the faculty of the future. India's differentiation is Saraswati, not Lakshmi. We can create the billionaires of the world. I honestly believe that can happen. But the software that we have inside us and the desire for learning, the desire for intellectual curiosity and others that is there, that should be who we are. No challenge ahead of you is greater than the force behind you. I want to end this thing. You always have Dipak Jain behind you. If a person who grew up in a small town in Tejpur can become the dean of Kellogg or INSEAD or in China, every Indian can do better than what I did. Never went to an English medium school, nothing, but I always had good people who gave me good advice, and my best mentors were my students. They always saw that this guy, I was not a good teacher. Students came to me and said, Professor Jain, we see a good teacher inside you, and this evening is our promise, we will make you the best teacher. Feedback, when students give you feedback, they mean it sincerely. Feedback may have a bitter taste, but a better aftertaste. So when somebody gives you something to say, don't take it personally. So I thank Amit for allowing me to be here. But I can tell you, Dipak Jain is always behind you. Let's all work together and make this country the Mecca of education, the Mecca of deans, the leadership of management education, and I can rest assure you, if we work collectively, the best days are ahead of us. Thank you.